curved old log back in the brackets the other way around. The curve pointing in toward him, not out away from him. Clamping the doors with extra efficiency instead of allowing the foot of loose movement it had allowed before. He pictured the log as he had seen it. More than a foot thick. Warped, but dry like iron. Curving away, it was no problem. Curving in, it would be immovable. He glanced at the army trucks. Gave it up. There was no space to hit the doors with any kind of momentum. The truck would be pressing on them with all the torque of a big diesel engine. But it wouldn't be enough. He couldn't imagine how much force it could take to shatter that old log. He thought about using a missile. Gave it up. Too noisy, and it wouldn't work anyway. They didn't arm themselves until they were 30 feet into the air. And they only carried 6.5 pounds of explosive. Enough to smash a jet engine in flight. But 6.5 pounds of explosive against those old timbers would be like scratching at them with a nail file. He was trapped inside, and Polly was waiting. It was not in his nature to panic. Never had been. He was a calm man, and his long training had made him calmer. He had been taught to assess and evaluate, and to use pure force of will to prevail. You're Jack Reacher, he had been told. You can do anything. First his mother had told him, then his father, then the quiet, deadly men in the training schools. And he had believed them. But at the same time, he hadn't believed them. Part of his mind always said, you've just been lucky. Always lucky. And in the quiet times, he would sit and wait for his luck to run out. He sat on the stony ground with his back against the timbers of the door and asked himself, has it run out now? He flicked the flashlight beam around the cavern. The rats were staying away from him. They were interested in the darkness in back. They're deserting me, he thought. Deserting the sinking ship. Then his mind clicked in again. No, they're interested in the tunnels, he thought. Because tunnels lead places. He remembered the giant mouse holes blasted into the rock face, north wall of the bowl. Maybe all interconnected by these narrow seams and back. He ran back into the depth of the cavern, past the trucks, past the grotesque heap of corpses, back to where he could no longer stand. A rat disappeared into the seam to his left. He dropped on his stomach and flicked the flashlight on, crawled after it. He crawled into a skeleton. He scrabbled with his feet and came face to face with a grinning skull. And another. There were 4 or 5 skeletons jammed into the excavated seam. Jumbled bones in a pile. He gasped in shock and backed off a foot. Looked carefully. Used the flashlight close up. All males. He could see that from the 5 pelvises. The skulls showed gunshot wounds. All in the temples. Need entry wounds. Need exit holes. Jacketed high-velocity handgun bullets. Fairly recent. Certainly within a year. The flesh hadn't decayed. It had been eaten off. He could see the parallel scrape marks on the bones from rodent teeth. The bones were all disturbed. The rats had hauled them away to eat. There were scraps of clothing material here and there. Some of the rib cages were still covered. Rats don't disturb clothing much. Not on the torso. Why should they? They eat their way in through the inside, the soft parts first. They come to the ribs from the back. The clothing material was khaki and olive green. Some black and gray camouflage. Reacher saw a colored thread. Traced it back to a shoulder flash hidden under a gnawed shoulder blade. It was a curved felt badge embroidered in silk. It said, Northwestern Freeman. He pulled at the skeleton's jacket. The ribcage collapsed. The breast pocket had 3 chromium stars punched through. Reacher made a thorough search, lying on his stomach, up to his armpits and bones. He pieced together 5 separate uniforms. He found 2 more badges. One said, White Christian Identity. The other said, the leaders who had abandoned their members to Bull Borkum. The roof was too low for Reacher to climb over the bones. He had to push them aside and crawl through them. The rats showed no interest. These bones were picked clean. Their new feast lay back inside the cavern. They swarmed back in that direction. He held the flashlight out in front of them and pushed on into the mountain against the squealing tide. He lost his sense of direction. He hoped he was going roughly west, but he couldn't tell. The roof came down to a couple of feet. He was crawling through an old geological seam, excavated long ago for its ore. The roof came down even more, down to a foot and a half. It was cold. The seam narrowed. His arms were out in front. The seam became too narrow to pull them back. He was crawling down a slim rock tube, a billion tons of mountain above him. No idea where he was going. And the flashlight was failing. The battery was spent. Its light was fading to a dull orange glow. He was breathing hard and shaken. Not from exertion, from dread, from terror. This was not what he had expected. He had visualized a stroll down a spacious abandoned gallery, not this narrow crack in the rock. He was pushing himself head first into his worst childhood nightmare. He was a guy who had survived most things, and he was a guy who was rarely afraid. But he had known since his early boyhood that he was terrified of being trapped in the dark in a space too small to turn his giant frame. All his damn childhood nightmares had been about being closed into tight spaces. He lay on his stomach and screwed his eyes shut, lay and panted and gagged. Forced the air in and out through his clamping throat. Then he inched himself slowly onward into the nightmare. The glow from the flashlight finally died 100 yards into the tunnel. The darkness was total. The seam was narrowing. He was pushing his shoulders down. He was forcing himself into a space that was way too small for him. His face was forced sideways. He fought to stay calm. He remembered what he had said to Borkum. People were smaller then. Scrappy little guys, migrating west, seeking their fortune in the bowels of the mountain. People half the size of Reacher, squirming along, maybe on their backs, chipping the bright veins out of the rock roof. He was using the dead flashlight like a blind man uses a white cane. It smashed on solid rock 2 feet ahead of his face. He heard the tinkle of glass over the rasping of his breath. He struggled ahead and felt with his hands. A solid wall. The tunnel went no farther. He tried to move backward. He couldn't move at all. To push himself backward with his hands, he had to raise his chest to get leverage. But the roof was too low to let him do that. His shoulders were jammed up hard against it. He could get no leverage. His feet could push him forward, but they couldn't pull him backward. He went rigid with panic. His throat clamped solid. His head hit the roof, and his cheek hit the grit floor. He fought a scream by breathing fast. He had to go back. He hooked his toes into the grit, turned his hands inward, and planted his thumbs on the floor. Pulled with his toes, and pushed with his thumbs. He moved backward a fraction. And then the rock clamped hard against his sides. To slide his weight backward, his shoulder muscles were bunching and jamming against the rock. He breathed out and let his arms go limp. Pulled with his toes. They scrabbled uselessly in the grip. He helped them with his thumbs. His shoulders bunched and jammed again. He jerked his hips from side to side. He had a couple of inches spare. He smashed his hands into the shale and heaved back. His body jammed solid like a wedge in a door. He tilted sideways and banged his cheek on the roof, jerked back down, and caught his other cheek on the floor. The rock was crushing him on his ribs. This He felt their weight on his legs. They were swarming over him. They burrowed up around his shoulders, slid under his armpits. He felt cold, oily fur on his face as they forced their way past. The flick of their tails as they ran ahead. To where? He let them run over his arm to estimate their direction. They were moving ahead of him into the blind darkness. He felt with his hands. Back and lay gasping on the grid, gasping and shaking, staggered to his feet and looked back. her face and smiled. "That should do it," he said quietly. "Bed frames are good for that." She took a last look at the room and gently closed the door, followed him through the door and down the stairs, across the lobby and through the double doors, and out into the bright, silent moonlight. "Christ," she said urgently. "What happened to you?" He glanced down and checked himself over in the light of the moon. He was gray from head to foot with dust and grit. His clothing was shredded. He was streaked with sweat and blood, still shaking. "Long story," he said. "You got somebody in Chicago you can trust?" "McGraw," she said immediately. "He's my agent, George White." They crossed the wide street arm in arm, looking left and right. Skirted the mound in front of the ruined office building, found the path running northwest. "You need to send him a fax," he said. "They've got missiles. You need to warn him tonight, because their line is going to be cut first thing in the morning."
"The mall tell him that?"
she asked. He nodded.
"How?" she asked. "How was he communicating?"
"Shortwave radio," Ranger said.
"Has to be.
Anything else is traceable." He swayed and leaned on a tree. Gave the spread, everything, beginning to end. She said,
"Ground the air missiles. Mass suicide. A nightmare."
"Not our nightmare," he said. "We're out of here."
"We should stay and help them," she said. "The families."
He shook his head. "Best help is for us to get out," he said. "Maybe losing you will change their plan. And we can tell them about the layout around here."
"I don't know,"
she said. "I do," he said. "First rule is stick to priorities. That's you. We're out of here." She shrugged and nodded.
"Now?"
she asked. "Right now," he said.
"How?"
she asked. "Jeep through the forest," he said. "I found their motor pool. We get up there, steal the jeep. By then it should be light enough to find our way through. I saw a map in Borkin's office. There are plenty of tracks running east through the forest." She nodded, and he pushed out the tree. They hustled up the winding path to the bastion, a mile in the dark. They stumbled on the stones and saved their breath for walking. The clearing was dark and silent. They worked their way around beyond the wall to the back of the communications hut. They came out of the trees, and Reacher stepped close and pressed his ear to the plywood siding. There was no sound inside. He used the wire again, and they were inside within 10 seconds. Holly found paper and pen, wrote her message, dialed the Chicago fax number, and fed the sheet into the machine. It whirred obediently and pulled the paper through, fed it back out into her waiting hand. She hit the button for the confirmation. Didn't want to leave any trace behind. Another sheet fed out. It showed the destination number correct. Timed the message at 5:10 Friday morning, the 4th of July. She shredded both papers small and buried the pieces in the bottom of a trash can. Reacher rooted around on the long counter and found a paper clip. Followed Holly back out into the moonlight and relocked the door. Dodged around and found the cable leading down from the shortwave whip into the side of the hut. Took the paper clip and worried at it until it broke. Forced the broken end through the cable like a pin. Pushed it through until it was even, a fraction showing at each side. The metal would short-circuit the antenna by connecting the wire inside to the foil screen. The signal would come down out of the ether, down the wire, leak into the foil, and run away to ground without ever reaching the shortwave unit itself. The best way to disable a radio: smash one up and gets repaired. This way, the fault is untraceable until an exhausted technician finally thinks to check.
"We need weapons,"
Holly whispered to him. He nodded. They crept together to the armory door. He looked at the lock, gave it up. It was a huge thing, unpickable.
"I'll take the Glock from the guy guarding me," he whispered.
She nodded. They ducked back into the trees and walked through to the next clearing. Reacher tried to explain his appearance to Joseph Ray. Figured he might say something about being beamed over to the UN. Talk about how high-speed beaming can rip you up a little. They crept around behind the punishment hut and listened. All quiet. They skirted the corner and Reacher pulled the door. Walked straight into a 9mm. This time, it wasn't a Glock. It was a Sig Sauer. Not Joseph Ray's. It was Bo Borkum's. He was standing just inside the door, with little Stevie at his side, grinning. Chapter 37. 4:30 in the morning, Webster was more than ready for the watch change. Johnson and Garber and the General's aide were dozing in their chairs. McGraw was outside with the telephone linemen. They were just finishing up. The job had taken much longer than they had anticipated. Some kind of interface problem. They had physically cut the phone line coming out of York and bent the stiff copper down to a temporary terminal box they had placed at the base of a pole. Then they had spooled cable from the terminal box to the road to the mobile command vehicle, connected it into one of the communications ports. But it didn't work. Not right away. The linemen had fussed with multimeters and muttered about impedances and capacitances. They had worked for 3 solid hours. They were ready to blame the army truck for the incompatibility when they thought to go back and check their own temporary terminal box. The fault lay there. A failed component. They wired in a spare and the whole circuit worked perfectly. 4:35 in the morning. McGraw was shaking their hands and swearing them to silence when Webster came out of the trailer. The two men stood and watched them drive away. The noise of their truck died around the curve. Webster and McGraw stayed standing in the bright moonlight. They stood there for 5 minutes while McGraw smoked. They didn't speak, just gazed north into the distance and wondered. "Go wake your boys up," Webster said. "We'll stand down for a spell." McGraw nodded and walked down to the accommodation trailers, roused Milosevic and Brogan. They were fully dressed on their bunks. They got up and yawned, came down the ladder, and found Webster standing there with Johnson and his aide, Garber standing behind them. "The telephone line is done," Webster said. "All ready," Brogan said. "I thought it was being done in the morning." "We figured sooner was better than later," Webster said. He inclined his head toward General Johnson. It was a gesture which said, "He's worried, right?" "Okay," Milosevic said. "We'll look after it." "Wake us at 8, Webster said. "Or earlier if necessary, okay?" Brogan nodded and walked north to the command vehicle. Milosevic followed. They paused together for a look at the mountains in the moonlight. As they paused, the fax machine inside the empty command trailer started whirring. It fed its first communication face to the message tray. It was 10 to 5 in the morning, Friday the 4th of July. Brogan woke General Johnson an hour and 10 minutes later, 6 o'clock exactly. He knocked loudly on the accommodation trailer door and got no response, so he went in and shook the old guy by the shoulder. "Here's an Air Force base, sir," Brogan said. "They need to talk to you." Johnson staggered up to the command vehicle in his shirt and pants. Milosevic joined Brogan outside in the pre-dawn glow to give him some privacy. Johnson was back out in 5 minutes. "We need a conference," he called. He ducked back into the trailer. Milosevic walked down and roused the others. They came forward, Webster and the General's aide yawning and stretching, Garber ramrod straight. McGraw was dressed and smoking. Maybe hadn't tried to sleep at all. They filed up the ladder and took their places around the table. Bleak red eyes, air fuzzed on the back from the pillows. "Peterson called," Johnson told them. "They're sending a helicopter search and rescue out. First light, looking for the missile unit." His aide nodded. "That would be standard procedure," he said. "Based on an assumption," Johnson said. "They think the unit has suffered some kind of mechanical and electrical malfunction." "Which is not uncommon," his situation were seen to have disobeyed Washington by making an issue out of it before Monday. Okay, so what's the downside? Webster asked. Theoretically, Johnson said, we have to assume they've been captured. So we also have to assume they've been well hidden, in which case the Air Force will never find them. They'll just fly around for a while and then go home and wait. Webster nodded. Okay, he said. No upside, no downside, no problem. There was a short silence. So we sit tight, Johnson said. We let the chopper fly. McGraw shook his head, incredulous. Suppose they use them to shoot the chopper down, he asked. The general's aide smiled an indulgent smile. Can't be done, he said. The IFF wouldn't allow it. IFF, McGraw repeated. Identify friend or foe, the aide said. It's an electronic system. The chopper will be beaming a signal. The missile reads it as friendly, refuses to launch. Guaranteed, McGraw asked. The aide nodded. Foolproof, he said. Garber glowered at him, but he said nothing. Not his field of expertise. Okay, Webster said. Back to bed. Wake us again at 8, Brogan. On the tarmac at Peterson, a Boeing CH-47D Chinook was warming its engines and sipping the first of its 858 gallons of fuel. A Chinook is a giant aircraft whose twin rotors thump through an oval of air 100 feet long and 60 wide. It weighs more than 10 tons empty, and it can lift another 11. It's a giant flying box, the engines and the fuel tank strapped to the top and the sides, the crew perched high in the front. Any helicopter can search, but when heavy equipment is at stake, only a Chinook can rescue. Because of the holiday weekend, the Peterson dispatcher assigned a skeleton crew of two. No separate spotter. He figured he didn't need one. How difficult could it be to find five army trucks on some shoulder in Montana?
You should have stayed here,
Borkin said. Right, John. Reacher glanced into the gloom inside the punishment hut. Joseph Ray was standing to attention on the yellow square. He was staring straight ahead. He was naked, bleeding from the mouth and nose.
Right, Joe?
Borkin said again. Ray made no reply. Borkin walked over and crashed his fist into his face. Ray stumbled and fell backward, staggered against the back wall, and scrambled to regain his position on the square.
I asked you a question,
Borkin said. Ray nodded. The blood poured off his chin.
Reacher should have stayed here, he said.
Borkin hit him again, a hard straight right to the face. Ray's head snapped back. Blood spurted. Borkin smiled.
No talking when you're on the square, Joe, he said. You know the rules.
Borkin stepped back and placed the muzzle of the Sig Sauer in Reacher's ear. Used it to propel him out into the clearing. Gestured Stevie to follow.
You stay on the square, Joe,
he called over his shoulder. Stevie slammed the door shut. Borkin reversed his direction and used the Sig Sauer to shove Reacher toward him.
Tell Fowler to get rid of this guy, he told him. He's outlived his usefulness, such as it ever was. Put the bitch back in her room. Put a ring of sentries right around the building. We got things to do, right? No time for this shit. Parade ground at 6:30. Everybody there. I'm going to read them the proclamation before we fax it.
McGraw couldn't sleep. He walked back to the accommodations trailer with the others and got back on his bunk, but he gave it up humming of the equipment behind him. He turned to sit down. The clock ticked around the 7. The fax machine started whirring. Polly smoothed her hands over the old mattress like Reacher was there on it. Like it was really his body under her, scarred and battered, hot and hard and muscular. Not a worn striped cotton cover stuffed with horse hair. She blinked the tears out of her eyes, blew a deep sigh, and focused on the next decision. No Reacher, no Jackson, no weapon, no tools, 6 sentries in the street outside. She glanced around the room for the 1,000th time and started scoping it out all over again. McGraw woke the others by thumping on the sides of the accommodations trailer with both fists. Then he ran back to the command post and found a 3rd copy of the message pulling out of the machine. He already had 2, now he had 3. Webster was the first end of the trailer, then Johnson a minute behind, then Garber, and finally the general's aide. They rattled up the ladder one by one and hurried over to the table. McGraw was absorbed in reading. What, Mac? Webster asked him. They're declaring independence, McGraw said. Listen to this. He glanced around the 4 faces, started reading out loud. Governments are instituted among men, he read, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. It is the right of the people to alter or abolish them after a long train of abuses and usurpations. They're quoting from the original, Webster said. Paraphrasing, Garber said. McGraw nodded. Listen to this, he said again. The history of the present government of the United States is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all designed to establish an absolute tyranny over the people. What the hell is this? Webster said. 1776 all over again? It gets worse, McGraw said. We therefore are the representatives of the free states of America, located initially in what was formerly York County and what was formerly Montana, and we solemnly publish and declare that this territory is now a free and independent state, which is absolved of allegiance to the United States, with all political connection totally dissolved. That as a free and independent state has full power to levy war, conclude peace, defend its land borders and its airspace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other things as all independent states may do. He looked up, shuffled the 3 copies into a neat stack, and laid them on the table in silence. Why 3 copies? Garber asked. 3 destinations, McGraw said. If we hadn't intercepted them, they'd be all over the place by now. Where? Webster asked. First one is a DC number, McGraw said. I'm guessing it's the White House. Johnson's aide scooted his chair to the computer terminal. McGraw read him the number. He tapped it in, and the screen rolled down. He nodded. The White House, he said. Next. New York somewhere, McGraw said. Read out the number from the 2nd sheet. United Nations, the aide said. They want witnesses. 3rd one, I don't know, McGraw said. Area code is 404. Atlanta, Georgia, Garber said. What's in Atlanta, Georgia? Webster asked. The aide was busy at the keyboard. CNN, he said. They want publicity. Johnson nodded. Hard moves, he said. They want it all on live TV. Christ, can you imagine? His umpires and round-the-clock coverage on the cable news, the whole world watching. So what do we do? Webster asked. There was a long silence. Why did they say airspace? Garber asked out loud. They were paraphrasing, Webster said. 1776, there wasn't any airspace. The missiles, Garber said. Is it possible they disabled the IFF? There was another long silence. They heard a car pull up, doors slammed. Brogan and Milosevic rattled up the ladder and stepped into the hush. They carried brown bags and styrofoam cups with plastic lids. The giant search and rescue Chinook made it north from Peterson in Colorado to Malmstrom Air Force Base outside of Great Falls, Jackson, Montana, without incident. It touched down there, and fuel bowsers came out to meet it. The crew walked to the mess for coffee, walked back 20 minutes later, took off again, and swung gently in the morning air before lumbering away northwest. Chapter 38. See if we can persuade them to restore our fax line.
Terrific plan, Ranger said.
The fax line is important, you see,
Fowler said.
Like, the world must be allowed to know what we're doing here. The world must be allowed to watch and witness. History is being made here, you understand that, right?
Ranger stared at the wall.
They've got cameras, you know.
Seeing you nailed to a tree. You're nothing but a piece of shit.
good cop, the friend, the ally, the protector. The oldest routine in the book, requiring the oldest response. Reacher glanced around. Two guards, one on each side of him. The right-hand guard nearer, the left-hand guard back almost against the side wall. Rifles held easy in the crook of their arms. Fowler behind them.